Good afternoon, everyone, and we welcome you to another exciting episode of the Lenovo LCL 2017 Spring Term. We will be your shoutcasters for Game 1. I am Vulcan, and joining with me is my co-caster, Atlas. So, Atlas, what conference are we on this week?
We're actually in North Luzon right now. We've just made full circle, almost, and it's going to be very exciting today.
What can you say about the North Luzon?
North Luzon, they're not very centralized, because North Luzon is pretty huge. You can see in other conferences, the strongest teams are either in this one part
saturated
of the region.
Saturated area.
Saturated area. But in North Luzon, it's very scattered. You've got rookies with lots of potential in every single part of it. We've got two teams from Baguio, one from Bulacan, one from Tarlac, one from Pangasinan. There's a lot. And they're not all and the strongest teams are not centralized in one spot. So they're really vying for this week's theme, control. Over this conference, which is very, very exciting to see from a narrative point of view.
So that said, I mean, it's been a long time since we had our new episode. So let's refresh ourselves of the format we are running on the LCL. So of course, we have from 48 conferences and to 16 to 4 and to 2. These are 6 conferences, right? Correct? And
yep.
From 6, we get like 8 teams. And that's why we have 48 teams, if my math is not that bad, because this is the LCL collegiate level. And after that, 16 conference groups, because we're only going to pick 2 of the top teams in each conference. That's why we only have 16.
Yeah, 2 to 3. We're getting 3 from each Luzon conference, which will total to 16 total teams in interconference groups, which will be narrowed down to 4 in the playoffs, in this coming to the quarters and semis. And then in the finals, it's going to be the battle between Titans, just 2 teams, at the very end of the spring term.
I mean, with that said, we have the spring format, and we also have our schedule, which is going to come up soon. We have 6 games today for the LCL, so with the schedule set,
let's look at the standings so far. You can see that leading right now are the University of Cordillera Scythe. That's pretty edgy. I like it. With 4 wins, 100% win rate so far. Following behind them is Holy Angel University Force Majeure or Superior Force. They were a strong rookie from last term. Top three will be... top 3 and 4. Very, very strong with the same win-lose rate. It's definitely very strong. Lots of potential. Very strong competition coming into this conference.
I'm pretty sure that the top one, the University of Cordillera, really strong, 100% win rate. That's
yeah.
Really something. Just goes to show how, just because that, you know, they're not really saturated in one certain area like other conferences, it just goes to show how strong they are.
Mm-hmm.
So here we have the schedule. First game would be St. Mary's University against Bulacan State University Golden Gears. And we have the succeeding games, University of Cordillera and St. Louis University. What can you say about St. Mary's University in our first game against Bulacan State University?
Yeah, St. Mary's University, Marian never give up, like Royal never give up. They're a returning team from last term. They were here last term. But this term, they're trying to do better. They're training to become better than they were before. Because right now, their standings aren't spectacular. They haven't shown a lot of their potential, even though it's there.
As far as I know, I think Bulacan State is a rookie team, whereas
yeah.
St. Mary's University, they have been here in the previous term, mm-hmm. but not as strong.
Yeah, they're
as
not
Bulacan
very
State.
Standout, but Golden Gear... Bulacan State University Golden Gear, they're new. They're new, right? But when you see them play, when you see them act, it's just very organized. It's very organized, very impressive, actually. Their standings actually show it. They have better standings than St. Mary's University right now with their 3-5 compared to 1-5. So
1-5,
yeah.
That's 20%
yeah.
win rate.
It's still better than, yeah.
Compared to Bulacan State, that's 60%.
And what's notable here was they beat SLU. Before in this conference, this term, they beat SLU, and SLU, St. Louis University Deus Vult, was actually the top 4 in the spring 2016, spring term 2016, the very top 4 of the entire LCL. So that's very, very strong.
And I hope for the
lots of potential.
The returning team, most likely this from the standings alone, the rookies have a really strong chance against a returning team like St. Mary's University.
Yeah.
I'm pretty scared for St. Mary's. I mean, a 20% win rate, that's a pretty low.
Yeah, that's very, very low. But yeah, they are still, the mindset is they want to do better. And they want to show that by beating a team that's new yet organized, and they want to beat that. But we're going to have to see, coming to the first game today, we're going to see how much they've improved since their unstreamed games, since the qualifiers. It's definitely going to be a journey for all of these teams. But if St. Mary's University can't show their prowess, even against Bulacan State University Golden Gears, yeah, their future might be bleak. But again, let's give them the benefit of the doubt right now. Even with our 20% win rate, they can redeem themselves, I believe.
I guess we're ready for the drafting phase, and let's get straight to it to see how will they strategize and how will they prepare for their victory. St. Mary's University on the blue side against Bulacan State University on the red side. Opening bands, Ivern and Ekaterina.
I think the Ivern's a very understandable band here. You can see the St. Mary's University will lose one band because they have subbed in a player who is not registered to that specific role. So they will lose one ban, but their bans here, it really constricts your choice, but they really do not want to deal with the Ivern and the Katarina. The bans on Bulacan State University Golden Gears, however, are going to be the Oriana, the Ari, and the Kha'Zix. Very mid lane centric, plus they don't want to deal with that assassination.
And for St. Mary's University, they have a penalty, so they cannot ban their third ban. So that's going to give Bulacan State University an advantage just from the drafting phase alone.
A strategy advantage here. Let's see if they are able to make good use of that. The first pick here coming from St. Mary's is going to be the Lee Sin. Following it up with a Jax and a Syndra. Very, very damaging, and it's a fighting composition they've drafted here. They want to go in, get a kill, and then follow it up from there. The response here, though, is going to be Darius, Graves, Victor, and Sivir. I have not seen Sivir in a while in this level of play. What do you think, Vulcan?
Well, Sivir is the type of champion you pick up when you're going to be lane focused.
Yes.
Push heavy, and in my opinion, in the Philippine server, they have a really hard time adjusting to a composition where you just go straight forward.
Yeah.
Straightforward inside, that's severe.
Oh, they're even picking up the Nami here, so there's lots of speed boost. Go in, initiate with a tidal wave, and the rest of them can just ride the speed boost from the Nami passive there, combined with the On the Hunt. That's going to make MG Exclusive's approach much, much easier, because Darius easily gets kited, but with a Sivir, with a Nami, it's going to be a lot deadlier.
I can't say that. I mean, we know that St. Mary's, they picked first,
yes.
And the second pick was the Darius and the Graves. And note how St. Mary's countered that Darius with a Jax. In terms of juggling around in top lane, Darius will have a really hard time, and not to mention in team fights, knowing that there is a Syndra. That's going to be really huge.
Very, very hard to go near, especially with a scatter the weak.
Yeah, that's not something you pick up really early on. I mean, if you show your cards like Darius in your first pick.
Yeah, because Darius is a very heavy card. It's like showing your ace already right straight off the bat. Yep. And it gives a lot of information. But it seems like they planned this from the get-go, the Sivir composition, because most teams don't expect the Sivir composition, as you said. But the Sivir might actually help a lot if the Scatter the Weak, as well as the Counter-Strike, are dodged by MG Exclusive.
Do you play Darius, Atlas?
Not a lot. I actually prefer more simpler top laners like...
Simpler top laners like Garen. Nautilus or Mount
Garen. I'm bronze, JK. But yeah. It's going to be very difficult for MG Exclusive to survive coming to the mid lane and late game. But again, if the team's as organized as they seem, it might be a lot easier than we're discussing.
It's really interesting to see how Bulacan State University is going to fare against, obviously, St. Mary's University's stronger lineup.
I want to see how the support misfortune is going to fare, actually.
This time in this patch?
Yeah, in this patch, because... Yeah, the laning got nerfed because the strength of Ashe and Misfortune in the lane is how much they can trade. With the double up, being able to just steal tons of damage on the squishy. But right now,
it's been changed.
Yeah, it's been changed. So I'm really not sure how this is going to work out. They have a pretty good level 6 spike, but how is that going to fare against, say, if they get counter ganked by Anjo, if Blanc and Ralph can just go straight in and fight them with their CC, with their kiting.
But I think an Ashe pickup is, in this meta, this patch, is pretty strong. The Warrior's Bloodlust has been reworked, so that's going to benefit a heavy, let's say, movement speed oriented ADC like Ashe. She has slow, so easy kite for her.
Easy kite, but yeah, as we've said, the Enchanted Crystal Arrow can still be spell shielded. That's a very big cooldown if it is timed correctly. Plus, the speed boost from On the Hunt might be able to mitigate some of the kiting potential. But yeah, it's all going to play out there in the bot lane. But still, I always say this in any game in PGS and LCL, it's going to be all about the junglers. Because if the junglers are not able to bring out pressure, their lanes just can't do anything.
Knowing that there is a Lee Sin jungle,
yeah,
we can expect that St. Mary's University will be heavily oriented in early ganks. If you are a Lee Sin and you don't gank in 3-minute mark,
that's pretty bad.
That's pretty bad.
That's pretty bad because his kit doesn't scale very well. His entire design as a champion does not scale very well into late game, so he really needs to snowball himself and his lanes.
And not to mention the Dragon's Range has been nerfed.
Yes.
So damage-wise, he's not going to be very strong anymore in the late game, so pure utility.
So he's definitely going to have to either snowball or get relegated to that tank role, disruption role, rather, later into the game. But we're going to have to see the Bulacan State University jungler, however, also needs to bring out lots of pressure, despite being a Graves, to match that Lee Sin. Just can power farm to 6 and burst people down once he gets to his counter gank. Says he has high damage, not for direct ganks, but for countering ganks, as you said.
Power level till 6? What do you mean by that?
I mean, once he reaches his level 6, it's going to be a lot easier to finish off ganks.
So I thought that you were pretending that Graves should keep farming until level 6.
No. It's like, if he doesn't have like potentials to gank, he can counter jungler as well. He's lots of potential to high damage.
High damage indeed.
Yeah, he's one of those champions that can afford to.
Can
afford to. Because he has fast clear.
Fast clear, but compared to Lee Sin here, Lee Sin has more mobility.
Yeah, Lee Sin has a lot more mobility.
I'm placing my bets on that Lee Sin more than that Graves. But to our viewers out there, who do you think is going to win this game? Cheer for your school. I mean, if you're going to be watching the LCL, you should be rooting for your school. And we have our relivengaming.youtube.com/phgarena/live. We have a chat box. You know, you can tell how you feel about the game.
You spam your emotes. Wait, no. YouTube chat doesn't have emotes. But yeah, you can spam
but
your...
But you can emote on Facebook.
You can give those love reacts, those wow reacts. Hopefully none of those sad reacts if someone makes a bad play or angry reacts. If you are unsatisfied with how your school is doing. But I think these teams are going to give their all. Because Bulacan State University, they're up-and-coming team. They really want to show that they're new, that they're but they are very organized. And they can take away a spot here in North Luzon Conference. Well, St. Mary's University, Maria never give up. They really want to redeem themselves for this game. So I really think they will want to redeem themselves.
It's really hard to say that. I mean... Clearly, the rookies are not entering this game as the underdogs.
Yes.
But it is the returning teams entering as the underdogs. Really, I think it's really hard to say that a returning team is not performing as well as a rookie team. That's a pretty huge statement.
Yeah, that's a pretty huge statement. And that's pretty big momentum loss as well for a returning team like that. So I'm really wondering... What changed? I mean, they weren't very spectacular last term, but they weren't 1-5 as well, I don't believe. So we're going to see how all of that plays off once a game begins. And as we are loaded onto the Rift for a first game for today of the North Luzon Conference, it's going to be St. Mary's University, Maria Never Give Up on the blue side versus Bulacan State University, Golden Gear on the red side. And of course, again, we are your shoutcasters. I'm Atlas, and with me is Vulcan. Let's see how they play their level ones. It seems like Bulacan State University is making a little sneaky play here.
Uh-oh.
Doesn't seem like they're caught out by any wards so far. Very, very sneaky. Might just be laying down the vision, but doesn't seem like they will be able to get anyone with their aggressive invade. Seems like they know something's up in their own red buff, pinging that down there. So caution will be advised what is going to happen in this level one.
Pretty close call for Zagan.
He
actually moved around the jungle pretty well. And what is this? A misfortune and Ashe in the mid lane?
Hmm. this might be something very, very interesting we're going to see in game one of today. But
Are they?
They're just standing around here. Zagan in a little bit of a danger spot. Does not go through the death zone. Or is he?
Oh, spotted.
But he does spot the red buff steal, so that's going to be a trade for the red buffs down there. Mayonnaise.
Mayonnaise should not do that.
Red buff applied.
Red buff slow. The end of the line. Aqua prison.
That was unfortunate. That was very bad pathing there coming from Mayonnaise. Zaga already spotted them out there. They knew that that was a red buff. They knew there was a Nami there as well as these Anjo. So the damage was there. And that actually gives first blood onto Blanc. Man.
That is something that St. Mary's University has to look out for. Ward the jungle.
And
if there is an invade going, knowing that Zagan backed away, why persist on checking something that's already taken away?
Yeah, the pathing there is way too dangerous there. I think actually the biggest thing here...
Rab with a second successful Aqua Prison volley. That's actually a pretty strong volley.
Yeah. What is that flash from Mayonnaise trying to go for a trade, but that is definitely not worth it. I do not understand the reasoning behind that. That was just peculiar.
I am
baffled. This is like that Zizeroth Portal gaming from last week.
Let us not go there.
But yeah, I think the biggest impact of that first blood on Mayonnaise was that Zagan was left alone in the lane for a while, level 1 versus 2 laners, so that allowed for the Aqua Prison into that very good trade.
Yeah.
Not even a trade. It was just a few love taps
it's
there.
It's not even a trade. It was one-sided. They took away something, and St. Mary's University...
And I don't know why Mayonnaise tried to trade back with a flash, make it rain. Not very impactful. But it seems like now... Bulacan State University will be on the side, being pushed to their tower temporarily. MG Exclusive, surprisingly, doing well right now. Ooh, Anjo.
Last one is there. He goes for it. Rush right, not worth it.
But Zagan is in a dangerous spot.
Gets slowed by the enchantment. Oh. Another Aqua Prison to secure Bulacan State's second kill. Make that dream. No, it's not. Here comes the Lee Sin, and there's this thing going on. I mean, how to gank a Lee Sin? As a Lee Sin, rotate to the lane.
Yep.
Press Q. Miss. Go back to the farm.
Nice meme, Vulcan. But yeah, that definitely, if that Sonic Wave had hit, I think it would have been a trade kill with a damage, with a Thunder Lords as well. But misses it, just gets a free kill, and Zagan is a lot more behind than he was earlier. Man. That was unfortunate.
The focus is really at the bottom lane.
Yes.
The fact that they know that Zagan and Mayonnaise, it's a comp we've seen in the international scene, but not anymore right now in patch 7.5. But knowing that they're on a Sivir and a Nami, obviously you really want to offer pressure. And the fact that when the Nami lands the Aqua Prison, followed up with a Boomerang and a Ricochet,
lots of damage.
You're going to get a kill.
Probably even a kill. Likely. The kill, especially if you have your Graves jungle. Anjo just straight in with the damage, with the end of the line. That's a straight up kill. No, and Mayonnaise does not have the kit to protect Zagan.
That's the problem when you pick up a Missile Warrior support. Yeah. You don't have any kit to protect your AC.
Yeah, and with the nerfs to double up as well in 7.4, it's going to be very, very hard to lane from the get-go. Not enough damage to be impactful. And here, Blanc.
Let's really talk about the bottom lane. Keep that camera on the bottom lane. I mean, the fact that Ash... Okay, here's the thing. Bullet rain. You have it there. You have the slow from the volley. But there is not enough power.
There's not enough firepower. Because the double... Yeah, and to add insult to injury, the double up has been nerfed, as we keep discussing. So Blanc and Ralph can just straight up fight through the slows, and just, you're not gonna run away.
Yeah, that's not to mention there is the ebb and flow.
Heal up all of the poke.
The fact that the Misfortune support is aimed for a burst type. Here comes Ludwig for the gag. Dunked! Here comes the Hammer Rage passive! That's gonna be a deal for MGS exclusive. Here comes another apprehend. A camera just rolled to the mid lane, but there's something going on in the top lane. And now Ludwig forced to back under his turret.
This might actually be the first turret if Ludwig, Ludwig will recall, and seems like they will just keep pushing the tower here.
That was pretty close.
Yeah.
And not for Bulikan State, it's for St. Mary's University. If Ludwig still committed to the fight, obviously, MG exclusive didn't get the reset from the dunk.
Yeah.
But the fact that he still had his passive on, that was a really a close call for Ludwig.
Yeah. And Counter-Strike does not block that lead.
It does not.
Yep.
Does not.
So even with that, Kaixia dies there.
I've never seen a Jax. I've never seen a Jax top. Actually.
Yeah, me neither. I do remember some other LCL players do use Jax in the top lane. I remember some players in South Luzon actually use in the top lane Jax. One of them is very, very mechanically apt at that. But it's very uncommon, yeah. And looking at the lead that MG Exclusive has right now, it's not working out so far.
But in terms of the laning phase, yeah. MG Exclusive is doing its job. CS difference of 20.
Yeah, that's over half. He has twice the CS he has right now.
He is actually thinking of, oh, that's a good idea. Buy a Phage and pure
chain
defensive.
Best.
Just pure defensive against the Jax, that's pretty smart.
Yeah, because you can just out sustain and out damage in the long-winded fight. Ooh, that's a lot of dread
that's
damage coming from the
bot
lane.
That's the thing about the Nami support. The enchantment plus the slow and extra magic damage. Easy to land the Ricochet and the Boomerang. That's a setup for a Severe. Mm-hmm. And knowing that Bulikan State University picked their kit according to the bot lane, not the same for St. Mary's University where it's sort of a one-for-all. Like, look after yourself.
Yeah, and Zagan and Mayonnaise cannot match the trade that Blanc and Ralph can give out. So it's definitely very tragic for their laning phase right now, and it's going to be very slow scaling up.
Not to mention Zagan came back from the base. This pickup is another
Doran's.
Comes Ludwig. Setting up for the ultimate of Senda.
He's not expecting it.
Counter-Strike plus the stun. Scary Ludwig, a secondary stun and a burst to top it all off. MG exclusive goes down.
Chain Vest does not protect at all from the Unleashed Power. Jorz uses this opportunity to push the lane a little bit. Not much comes out of it. Just denies a little bit of farm. But in the end, it's still a pretty big win for St. Mary's University. And that does stop a little bit of the momentum from MG Exclusive, but it seems like Bulikan State University will use this opportunity to take the Cloud Drake. Will not be contested.
No wards are placed. That's four members in the pit. That will be their Cloud Drake.
Easy Cloud Drake. Gonna give Anjo a little bit of an easier time rotating around the lanes for his clear, for his counter ganks
and
as well.
And not to mention the synergy for Blanc on that Severe.
Ooh, yes. Just straight and run it down mid.
And
destroy
plus
everyone.
Yeah, the tidal wave will slow it up. That's actually, yeah. I think, but
it's slow. It knocks him up, slows it down, and speeds up your own team riding the wave as well. They just surf that wave. It seems like Ralph and Blanc will try to fight this bot lane.
On the hunt, Mayonnaise is caught off guard. Tidal wave burning the flash of Mayonnaise. Aqua prison. This is going to be Bad Angel, end of the line, but gives the kill to Blanc.
Yep, Angel just goes for a drive by here.
My.
And
it
seems like they will try to go for clearing this bot lane. Man, that was...
That's brutal.
That is brutal.
Very, very brutal. The fact that Mayonnaise is in the support role, and he's all alone, pushing the lane.
Yeah, very unwise
Very unwise.
And Zagan might actually be dove here, because no one is there
for
the response.
There, ready in arm, not going to land. But here comes the enchanted crystal arrow, exhaust burn onto Zagan. Here comes the heal, the volley, and the collateral damage secures the kill.
Yeah, that is the cost of Mayonnaise dying. Not only the kill, but
unleash the power with Ignite. No, the stun with the Chaos start. One more basic attack. Jorz gets the kill.
Yeah, this has just been by the books for... Oh, misses the Sonic Wave.
Ludwig, gonna go for the dive.
No. Will not.
Oh,
SMU's turret will go down.
That's why. Snap again couldn't. Oh, wait.
Gets stunned.
Force field stun.
Man, a gravity well doing some work from Jorz here might have actually saved him because the Dragon's Rage was up even with the nerf damage. And this actually might give them another turret after that bot lane. And earlier, yeah, Mayonnaise dying had more consequences than just 300 extra gold. It left Zagan open for a dive there, even with how he played it.
And I really want to mention what happened in the mid lane.
Yes.
Nabaget was supposed to kill Joris, but he was exhausted.
Yep.
During the channel of the Unleashed Power. That's why he was able to survive. And not to mention,
very good summoner spell choice
here. Summoner spell
even
choice.
With the nerfs don't matter for Joris if he uses it the way it's supposed to be as an anti-burst tool, and you can telegraph the Unleashed Power very, very well because the balls float and then they go straight at you. It's gonna be very easy to just press the exhaust to mitigate all of that damage. Four people on the Rift Herald, gonna be uncontested yet again. A free buff for BULSU. Let's see who's gonna get it. Probably gonna be MG exclusive to help his fight against Kaixia.
BULSU is on a roll right now, securing objectives from the bot lane to the top lane. Three turrets down, one Drake. St. Mary's University has nothing.
Engage.
Tidal wave on the hunt. Scaring the weak to stun two members of BULSU. They will still go for it. Here comes the Janker's arrow and the bullet time! Not damage, no damage at all whatsoever. Mayonnaise has to back away. Zagan too. Same as Ludwig. The right is going off into the riverside. Let's see. BULSU just standing off. Mayonnaise making his approach.
Seems like they will chill after that. But yeah, the bullet time. Nothing. No impact there whatsoever. They got them around below half health, but not enough to actually matter. Seems like they will transition this into a siege into the mid lane, just going to demolish that.
It's not going to be a siege at all. That's
it's not even a siege. It's just a demolition job here for Bulacan State University with five members getting more gold for their team. And then that's a 7.3 gold lead for them.
Wow.
Whoa, okay.
And the next rig will be a cloud. Oh, look at them. Three members. This is how you play.
Okay. Oh, just getting some deep wards here. Very, very good. Yep, nothing to get there anymore. Zagan and Mayonnaise have backed off with their recalls. Just a little bit of a slower pace right now until the next fight.
Almost going to be 40 minutes of the game. Ludwig has not done any successful ganks at all. With the KDA 011, I wouldn't say that very impressive compared to Anjo on that Graves.
Anjo has been doing very well. 302, the 5.0. KDA here doing a lot of work, but of course that's a lot of props to Ralph as well in those bot lane ganks. Very, very on point on those Aqua Prisons. The engages with a Tidal Wave. Just a very, very good trades there in the bot lane as well. Letting them pick up those trades, setting up for the kills later in the phase.
They're rookies, showing the returning team how it is done. You secure objectives.
Very organized.
Very, very organized. Very clean. I like how they play compared to St. Mary's University.
Not very impressive.
Yeah, not very impressive
so far. It's looking right now to be a 1-6, but they do have a few. They do have a few.
Counter strike up.
With a damage.
Stun lands on the Mekosift. Another stun following up. That's going to be Unleash Power from Nabahead to secure his second kill.
This could be one of the ways that they can get back in terms of gold. But if
pick off, I guess.
Yeah, keep picking off MG exclusive. If MG exclusive keeps going for that top lane split push, keeps going for that overconfident push into the second tier tower, they can capitalize on that, but that's not enough. They need to make these other pickoffs because their composition, I think they have a lot of potential. They have the Dragon's Rage, they have the Unleashed Power, they have the Enchanted Crystal Arrow. If they can get one or two people off guard, it's going to be a little bit of a catch-up rubber band for them. But with the way BULSU is playing, it seems it might be a blur to see that. Look at it. Deep wards all over their bot side. And Anjo is just taking over the farm from Ludwig here, preventing him from further coming back. He has double his CS.
I feel like BULSU made this comp knowing that there'll be a two cloud break. So let's see. Same as University setting up for steal. Bullet time, crystal
bullet time
arrow.
Bullet does not do anything
at all.
Oh.
Ludwig gets stunned on a Chaos Storm plus a collateral damage.
That's just overkill right there, but that's a lot more power to BULSU. And they're going for mid lane, but doesn't seem like there's anything
Tidal
here
wave.
Except...
Oh, that's going to be a panic flash. Nabahead. Item-wise, he's catching off, but not his team at all. looking at the itemization of the Ash.
Yeah, it seems like they're going to go for the top lane here. Kaisha has to back off. And with a pretty substantial wave here and five members, going to be another demolition job here in the top lane. Angel is clearing those minion waves before they can even defend.
Clearly, the bottom lane is very, very behind in itemization-wise. No main item, no sight. Oh, sorry. No support item finalized for Mayonnaise. He has to pick up a Black Cleaver in order for his
Might
bullet.
Be a fight here, though. Bulso is low on the resources here in terms of mana. Has to back off.
Yeah, and going back to what I just said, Mayonnaise has to pick up a Black Cleaver. Mm-hmm. If he really wants to deal a lot of damage for the bullet type and to peel armor for Zaga, that's something you want to do as a Mistborn.
He's so behind in gold. Still only has that Frost Fang plus a Sight Stone. Building into that boost of swiftness as well. It's going to be a very, very delayed Black Cleaver. It's just going to be a ticking clock here for SMU if they can't get their act together.
SMU.
Seems like they have a little bit of breathing room.
Yeah, SMU is trying to stall the game. That's pretty smart.
Yes.
If you want to build items. But the fact that the build path for Zagan is very bad in the 70-minute mark.
Yes.
Ruin's Hurricane. It's a bit
it could,
something that you want to go, but looking at his item-wise, it's a bit very behind.
So yeah, it's a very behind, kind of awkward at this point of the game to only have the recurve bow and the zeal. This cannot even get the tower there for the extra gold, but yeah, the Runan's Hurricane, if he does once he does finish it, will help him a bit with the wave clear to help relieve the pressure from the lanes. But when it comes to the actual, when Bulsu comes on knocking on the towers, it might not help a lot because they can just straight up destroy the towers, headbutt into the towers, and just destroy it, demolish it. And I don't think the Runans will be able to help, but he does have that finished at 18 minutes of the game. So far, they still have a lot of breathing room. Bulsu has just is yet to make another five-man play with the On the Hunt, but seems like they are wanting to. They are thirsty for blood. They're looking for it. And they're actually playing this very smartly. They're playing very aggressive, right? But they're also doing their best to relieve the vision. Oh, Kaisha.
That's going to be exhaust. Bit caught off guard. He's going to be all alone on that. A kill, a flash burn. And a nice collateral damage picked off.
And a mutual kill from the two mid laners on in the sideline, but still that is a little bit of a win for Bulsu, but at least the kill helps Nabahet catch up a little bit in terms of his goal. He's 3-3-0 right now. And he's the only one with a kill score in the side of SMU.
Yeah, SMU is really running a very unorthodox lineup. Jackstop. A very outdated support lineup in the bottom lane.
Yeah, it doesn't seem like it's working out, however.
It's patch 7.5.
Yeah.
Why would it work?
Yeah.
They have addressed that issue a long time ago, and I guess they didn't read the patch notes.
Oh man, is this going to be Zizeroth gaming all over again? Oh man, looking at the replay here, this is how George dies, gets kicked away into Nabahet, but the burst here allows him to just straight up fight him, but the Chaos Storm still there, able to finish off the kill. Mutual kill, a little bit of a more catch up for SMU actually, if you just take that mid lane kill on its own, because that's as an assist for Ludwig plus a kill for Nabahet.
Oh,
look at the damage.
I'm gonna help the Decimate was secure the kill for MG Exclusive.
MG Exclusive for the alley-oop. After Kaisha tries to run away.
No wards placed whatsoever on St. Mary's University side. If you check the minimum, it's pitch black. And
pitch
this
black.
Gives
Bulsu opportunity for a dragon. Baron.
An opener
here
for the Baron. This will be easy Baron.
No AD carry, non-top laner. Even the jungle is not in a position to contest it. Might be a free Baron buff here. And yeah, and that's the way Bulsu has been playing. Even if SMU has been putting only a meager amount of vision in their own jungle. And that's not how you do it, because when you're playing from behind, you really, really want to ward your own jungle, because you want to be able to farm up from your own on your own terms in your own territory. But Bulsu has not given them the opportunity to ward. They've either picked them off, cleared all of their wards with their red trinkets, and that's just blind map for SMU right now.
And not to mention, have you seen the itemization of that Misfortune support? AP.
Yeah.
of all the things to go, AP Misfortune.
Very, very unoptimized.
Not efficient, not optimized. This is SMU's itemization going down the drain. They don't know which to prioritize and which to actually know. Let's say, what is more important? Secure a drop desk, offer pressure to the lane, or rotate and itemize and farm. BULSU University, they know what to do. They get objectives. Instead of just farming and farming, they pressure the team. And that's
how they played all of their dives very, very cleanly as well. And not just the dives in the micro plays, the macro plays, the rotations, the vision control was there. And we're seeing lots of potential from this new team. They are boy wonders
very
right now.
Very organized, very strong. It just goes to show their win rate is 60% compared to...
That's very decent.
That's very decent. A returning team compared to the return team like St. Mary's University. 20% win rate, 1-5.
I really don't understand the draft coming from St. Mary's. Because if they prioritize the Lee Sin, then they should have a lot of trust in that. But Ludwig was not able to transition that first priority pick or pocket pick into the ganks that he needed, into the pressure that he needed. No snowballs whatsoever. Just a little, just go into lane, miss the sonic wave, and then very, very sadly go back to your own camps. So I don't understand. And the laning as well was horrendous. I have to be honest, that was horrendous coming from the bot lane of St. Mary's University. The top lane, I think the laning was inevitably bad, because it's early on, it's Jax versus the Darius. And then MG Exclusive was just playing it very nicely with his own sustain, with his bleed passive as well. Being able to survive that. A few hiccups because he kept getting three-man gank, but still very, very strong, and Kaishia just getting destroyed. The mid lane was a lot more even, I think.
I mean, it's only that Syndra.
Yeah.
The only kill in all this whole team. So to our viewers out there, we are experiencing some technical difficulties. That's why the game has been halted for a while.
Yeah, it's been paused for a bit.
We'll be going back to it shortly. But I gotta say, I mean, a rookie team to really show how it is done in an LCL scene. That is very refreshing to see.
Yeah. I'm actually satisfied not seeing any items that build from Raptor Cloak so far that spawn little purple insects going into towers. I've not gotten over from last week, but
we gotta get over that, Atlas. I mean, we are now on our new conference.
Yeah, we are in North of the Zone right now, but North of the Zone so far has given us an organized rookie team, but the returning team has a very confusing strategy, picking these weird champions here, unoptimized, not suited for the meta right now, especially the Jax and the Misfortune. You can see here, look at the damage coming from Jors.
Wow, 2v1.
Another mutual kill involving Ludwig, Nabeth, and Jors.
It doesn't matter you get a mutual kill or not. It does not matter because BULSU got the Baron.
Yeah.
They have two Drakes, 6 turrets.
And another Cloud Drake spawning here in 10 seconds. Seems like they're still eyeing that. That rotation power combined with the On the Hunt is going to be very, very sweet for them.
Why did the Misfortune build AP? I just don't understand why that Mayonnaise is optimizing a Misfortune on AP. Despite the fact that Bullseye now has scaling on the AD ratio, and the reason why Misfortune supports work is because they build AD.
Yeah, they build AD to shred people, and the Black Cleaver would help a lot. Would help Zagan, would help Ludwig, would help Kaishia a little bit as well. So I don't understand the itemization here coming to AP. There's a lot more that could have been done with AD. Oh, just
slash and
misses
lateral damage.
But still, it's going to be a transition here onto the inhibitor. And that's going to be, that is going to be the search and win link we have for today. Just follow that bit.ly. It's going
to
be a fight.
Tidal wave to ride. Zagan is there. Bullet time is not doing at all. Jazz is going to pursue for the graves. He picks up a kill. Now BULSU is just going to wipe out their base with a 2-1 tray with a Baron buff in their hands. That was very brutal.
It seems like they're still going for this push, even with these 20-second cooldowns, but again, that was the link to our Search and Win promo. We were going to have that for the other games as well for today. Just enter that link, fill up the form completely, answer the trivia, and you will be, and if you're fast enough, if you're quick enough on the draw, you will get that mystery gift inserted into your account in a few working days. But for now, let's look at BULSU just knocking on SMU's doors here. Just not even a fight.
Upper hand onto Ludwig, he tries to get away. Dragon Rage, three-man knockup, but there is no follow-up. Scarlet Ludwig will start. Ignite is there, but the shield and the ebb and flow will sustain that victor. He's not going to go down. Flash in, upper hand by MG Exclusive. However, exhausted, dunk. But wait, Blank instead picks
that's the
up
second
the
time that Blank has stolen the kill.
The glorious dunk.
From being dunked there, but it seems like this will be game one of today on the side of Bulacan State University. Golden Gear, very clean gameplay, and SMU not able to redeem themselves just yet or at all. It's going to be the Nexus down for SMU. It's going to be BULSU's first win of the day.
Congratulations for BULSU, securing a very, very nice and clean game. That's good, guys. Game one set. BULSU takes in that victory. I gotta say, I can't stress enough how BULSU played very clear. Without a doubt, I'm really surprised to see a rookie team not crumble under pressure just because they're a rookie. They showed their strengths, and it really paid off in the game.
I think it's all about the macro play here. It doesn't matter how good their mechanics. I mean, it matters how good their mechanics are, but they really need the organization, the macro play to go with it. And BULSU, Golden Gear, has that on point so far, bringing their win rate to 4-5. Is gonna be, that's pretty good. Four out of five.
In terms of itemization, it's sad to see that St. Mary's University did not optimize their champions properly. Rhino Scepter on a misfortune. You gotta be kidding me.
Yeah. Even if you say, oh, it's gonna slow everyone, it doesn't really help at all. Because you already have a lot of potential to slow stun.
The fact that you don't need a slow on the misfortune.
Because you already have the Enchanted Crystal Arrow, Scattered Awake, Counter-Strike. A lot of that to just set up for the rest of your team.
Not just that. Misfortune has a built-in slow
Yeah,
still.
A built-in slow as well. So all of those combined, you don't need the Rylai's. You just could have gone Black Cleaver, shredded everyone, helping your AD carry, your top laner as well. Actually, in some points of the game, a viewer could have probably forgotten that it was a Jax that Keisha existed. Because I did not see any impact from the top lane there. No teleport plays whatsoever. It's just straight up being destroyed by MG Exclusive, kept getting pushed into the tower. So all in all, it's not just Bulacan State U being very clean. They were very clean, but it's also St. Mary's University playing very strangely. Very, I have to say it, very bad.
The macro play shows up, and guys, there you guys have it. That is just game one of our episode for this stream. We have been your shoutcasters. I am Vulcan, and joining with me was my co-caster, Atlas. We'll be having a short break to return to game two, and you are watching the Lenovo LCL Spring Term 2017 Challenge. What you know, we'll be back after a short break.
They just followed that 50.
Tidal Wake is right. Sagan is there. Blue Tide is not doing at all. That's for the pursuit. Fourth is crazy. Picks up a kill now. Wipe out
there. Just not even a fight.
Upper hand on Ludwig, he tries to get away. Dragon Rage, three-man knockup, but there is no follow-up. Scarlet Ludwig will start. Ignite is there, but the shield and the ebb and flow will sustain that victor. He's not going to go down. Flash in, upper hand, but empty exclusive. However, exhausted, dunk. But wait, Blank instead picks
that's the
up
the second
kill.
Time the Blank has stolen the kill.
The glorious dunk.
This will be game one of today on the side of Bulacan State University. Golden Gear, very clean gameplay, and SMU not able to redeem themselves just yet or at all. Nexus down for SMU. BULSU's first win of the game.
Congratulations for BULSU, securing a very, very nice and clean game. That's good, guys. Game one set.